setting of the sun. I now let drift away everything and everyone that can no longer stay. Oh, the meek Holy Spirit, hold my heart and comfort me. Oh, the meek Holy Spirit, help me know how to let go.
Good morning. Welcome to Unity of Charlotte. My name is Marty Bacher, and it's my privilege to welcome you here this morning. We are here to love and to grow and to serve. We're here to embody and experience and practice unity principles that we might have a more deep and profound experience of the divine. We believe that spiritual community enhances our life, enhances our experience of life, makes it richer and deeper and stronger. So we're just grateful that you could be here this morning and be part of this day and all that goes on here. I want to welcome you if you're visiting us for the first time today. We will not make you stand up and share your most embarrassing moments, but we do want to make sure that you received a welcome packet and that you find some of our wonderful hosting team that'll help you find your way around. And we also want to let you know that we do have potluck today. We always like to do a lot of things together, but we really like to eat together. So we hope you'll join us for that. If you are in need of spiritual support, we invite you to place a prayer request in our Ministry of Prayer. That is located in the lobby. You can also go online to submit said requests, and it's always our privilege to pray with you. There are many wonderful things taking place in the community, and so this Saturday we're joining with the larger community to clean up around the creek, keeping things from going from the creek to the river to the ocean. And so if you'd like to be part of that, it's already happening. Just show up around 9 and be part of that. Also want to make you aware that there is a new series. We used to have a group called School of Spirituality. They have re-evolved. Can you re-evolve? I think you re-evolve. Anyways, they have a new name, is what I'm really trying to say, called Dialogue as Service, led by the one, the only, Barbara Rolfe. And so they're beginning a new series. Now, this is a group that doesn't just read a book for a week and call it good. They go deep. And so they're using Myrtle Fillmore's Healing Letters. So this new series, which will run somewhere around a year or so, is starting doing two things. One, there's a Tuesday night class that will be done online through a program called Zoom, which is lovely. You don't have to fight traffic. You can stay in your jammies. You'll want to contact Barbara. Her email address is barbara.rolfe@gmail.com, and she will send you the link to get you enrolled for that. So that's very exciting. We also have a wonderful workshop coming in on the 21st. Reverend Shelley Enting is doing a journey through the zodiac. And so this is a understanding sort of the metaphysics or the symbology of these 12. Notice how 12 always shows up, the 12 houses. So we're excited to have her here. That'll be right after the service on the 21st. Then John Stringer will be here on the 27th. Many of you know John. You've attended some of his workshops. Wonderful, deep musician, godlike being. And he's just going to be in town for the one day, so he's doing a workshop from 2 to 4, and we'll do private sessions afterwards. So if that's of interest to you, we invite you to avail yourself of that. I think that's the highlights. There's, of course, a ton of things going on, so we invite you to visit our website at unityofcharlotte.org, sign up for our email list. We do our best to keep you informed. At this point, let's begin the inward journey, though, as we center and ground into prayer and into that realization of the one life, the one power, the one infinite something of which we are all a part. And as we breathe deeply into this moment, we can reconnect with that life force. We are reminded of the words of closer than my hands and feet, nearer than my breath. This one life in which we live is expressing itself through us. So how grateful I am to offer this time of remembering who we are, of letting go of the littleness, the pettiness, the worries, the concerns, to open our heart to experience divine love, and our minds to infinite wisdom. I am grateful for these teachings which help us remember who we are, to live more fully, to be at peace. I'm grateful for this spiritual community and each and every person that plays such a vital role in its unfoldment, for the many hands and the many hearts that come together to provide this environment through which we grow. I am grateful for the many blessings. And I know that today is a day of allowing, a day of surrender, a day of letting go. That we are emboldened in the presence and the power of truth to live fully, to love graciously, to give generously, to experience heaven on earth. So for all of these blessings and so many more, I'm simply giving thanks. And as I release this word through the power of the living Christ, I know that it goes forth to be a blessing to all. In joy and gratitude, and I allow it to be so, as together we say, and so it is. Amen. Let's join together in speaking our words of truth, our July affirmation, together. Today, I celebrate my spiritual freedom. I gently release all limiting beliefs. I choose to express myself fully, freely, and powerfully. I know the joy of living my authentic life. Today, I celebrate my spiritual freedom. Thank you. Today's inspiration comes from two sources, both of whom I'm sure you know. Brené Brown, in a wonderful book called I Thought It Was Just Me, says, courage is a heart word. The root of the word courage is cor, the Latin word for heart. In one of its earliest forms, the word courage meant to speak one's mind by telling all one's heart. Over time, this definition has changed, and today we typically associate courage with heroic and brave deeds. But in my opinion, this definition fails to recognize the inner strength and level of commitment required for us to actually speak honestly and openly about who we are and about our experience, both good and bad. Speaking from our hearts is what I think of as ordinary courage. And Dr. Michael Beckwith writes, in this very moment, on the spot where you now stand, You can choose to be free regardless of what has transpired in your life, regardless of what they have said and are still saying about you, regardless of your opinion of yourself, regardless of any external fact. Right now, you can begin to identify the state of consciousness from where your choice-making occurs. Once you identify it, you can shift it. You can expand it into mindful awareness. Clear seeing emanates from your essential self, that place within you that has never been born and will never die. As Krishna taught his disciple, this self is never born, nor does it ever perish. Nor, having come into this existence, will it ever again cease to be. It is birthless, eternal, changeless, ever the same, unaffected by the usual processes associated with time. It is not slain when the body is killed. The essential self is a radiance of source, individualized into form as every man, woman, and child walking the planet. The delusory sense of separation from our source, coupled with our conditioning, causes forgetfulness of our inherent freedom, of our original state of being. And so we allow this to be a day when we not only remember, but have the courage to live our authentic life, to be our spiritual self in the world, to declare a new reality and to live according to that ideal. How blessed we are. Amen. Oh, honey, if you'll bring the choir mics down, I think it'll help that loop. We've got a... They're off? Well... If anything good comes on, let me know. I just want to keep track of the score on the game, so if anything happens, let me know on that. Let us be patient in our impatience. Who knows? Anyways, I have a special guest with us here today who in the last moment said, yes, of course I'll sing. And so I'm grateful for her. I'm grateful for her willingness. And as you all know, we love Kay Simpkins. Please welcome Kay Simpkins.
Hi, Unity. It's good to be home. How you doing today? How's everybody feeling this morning? Awesome, awesome, awesome. Y'all know I love my Reverend Marty, and I love everybody here, and I'm always glad when I can come into this house of the Lord and see everybody and see my Unity family, so it makes me happy. So the song that I'm going to sing this morning is called Every Rhythm is the Beat, and you've heard this before. It's one of Reverend Marty's favorites, I think. So, cross your fingers. When we're calling revolution, do we know just what it means? It means inner transformation, a truth that sets you free. Glory, glory, hallelujah, it's happening to me. Same blood, every rhythm is the beat. One body blown to pieces, one life, the light of us, one God and all religion, one love, one love. This is the cracking of the eggshell, the shedding of our skin. No, there is no savior out there. The Savior lies within. We're gonna break apart our own hearts so that everyone can see our blood, it is the same blood. Every rhythm is the beat. One body blown to pieces, one life, the light of us. One God and no religion. One love, one body bathed in glory. Light of the universe. One God and no religion. Pieces, one life, the light of us. One God and no religion. One love, one love. One body bathed in glory. Light of the universe. One God and no religion.
Kay Simpkins, thank you. Well, I hope you all had a wonderful 4th of July celebration. I know I did. I always love this time of year because it, for me, it's always a time to ground myself in principle. You see, it's funny, I'm a little bit of a student of history. I'm a little bit of a nerd, and so I... always kind of think it's funny how we celebrate the 4th of July as if that was the accomplished fact. Like, oh, we said we're free and yay, look at us. When in fact, those that know that was the beginning of a struggle that took years to satisfy itself, to fulfill itself, and the ideals that were set in motion, we still work to live up to. But it was a radical and fundamentally different idea that people would be governed by themselves. If you look at the history, this is a new concept. And so it's a brilliant, flawed experiment that we are in, that we continue to live for and to experience. What does it mean to have all people be created equal and to pledge ourselves to something greater than ourselves, to pledge ourselves to ideas and to laws? That it is the rule of law that determines who we are, not the person. So I had to nerd out because it's what I do. I'll tell you a quick story. Years ago, when I retired from ministry the first time, not very good at this retiring from ministry thing, by the way. Actually, I had fallen in love, and my partner was also a newly licensed minister, and I was experiencing burnout. And so I said, well, when I finish this gig, we'll go where you take us. which is how I ended up in Sun Valley, Idaho. Now, I went from Oklahoma City to Sun Valley, Idaho, and I said, clearly I like your God better, you know, ski resort, you know, lovely. And if you've never been to Sun Valley, Idaho, it's really one of the most beautiful places on earth, just stunning beauty, and it's this little charming resort town in the mountains. And so it had its early origins in, well, when it became a resort, was the first ski resort in the United States. Who knew, right? And a guy you may have heard of by the name of Harriman had this train line, which he mostly used to travel sheep around. And he got this idea that we could have a resort, like a European-style resort. We could build a resort, and there's mountains. We could build ski mountains. And in the West, we have real mountains. I don't mean to diss anyone, but I'm just saying. And so he had a brilliant idea of bringing all of Hollywood stars up to Sun Valley. So the origins of Sun Valley very much have their, sort of have this Hollywood culture. So needless to say, many, many people of fame and fortune have second and third homes there. So it's not uncommon to be walking down the street and run into a Bruce Willis or a Tom Hanks or a Steven Spielberg or, you know, all these people because where they live. And so the rule of being in a small resort town is everybody cool, you having coffee, finish your coffee, do your thing, and that's part of the charm of it. So I had just moved there, and my partner took the church in Sun Valley, and I was now the minister spouse, which is a new experience. And so a friend of mine had said, who managed the Sun Valley Writers Conference, which is amazing, said, we need help. Would you like to help? And I was like, I need money. So yes, I will. So one morning before the Sun Valley Writers Conference started, I had breakfast and was having breakfast at this little cute little place in town, and in walks David McCullough. Now, David McCullough had just written, or not just written, but John Adams, the book, was selling like crazy. And I'm like, oh my goodness, it's David McCullough. So he's sitting there having breakfast, and about 3 minutes later, Tom Hanks walks in. I'm like, oh my goodness. He sits down with David. They're having a conversation, and I'm like, something's going on here. So later, you know, went on. Dave McCullough was wonderful, and I just always had that in my mind. One day I'm watching TV, and Charlie Rose is interviewing Tom Hanks, and he says, yes, I've bought the rights to John Adams. I was at a little meeting and met David, and we've done the rights, and so we're bringing out a series on HBO. If you've never seen this series, it's remarkable. It's really well done. And so I was like, see, I was right. There was a deal, you know? And so that really began for me sort of a really a kind of an in-depth study of biographies of our founding fathers and mothers. Wonderful book, Founding Mothers, Cokie Roberts. You should all read it because the women, as usual, don't get credit for the role they played in keeping this thing moving forward. What I loved about all of that, and the reason I share that, is because I think it's good for us to return to our roots, to remember really how profound this experiment is, how radically different it is, and that it was designed towards ideals that this group of people said, we will pledge our all to this ideal, knowing full well what they were doing was revolution. And the crown was not happy about people revolting. But when we are in exploration, it's good to remember this because these principles are true for us. You may have noticed my goal is to look at this idea about the courage to be free. And when I talk about that, I talk about the courage to be free from our conditioning, our limitations that we have set upon ourselves. And what I know is that it is in the declaration that the struggle begins. You see, it's so lovely. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we just stood up on Sunday and said our five sentences of affirmation and walked out and money just was like thrown at you and people are like, yeah, right? We're like, whew, that was so good. But what I also know is that we have been conditioned to live a certain way. We are all pure spirit. We are all pure being. And yet we come to this planet and we begin to absorb all kinds of things. We begin to formulate who we are. And we live in such a way that is always in accordance with our belief about who we are. Some people think, I am powerful. And they live a powerful life. Some people think, I am weak and powerless. And they tend to live a weak and powerless life. Now, the conditions of their life may have informed that decision, but ultimately it was the decision that each one of us made that is what's playing out in our life. The good news is we can declare our independence at any given moment. So as I was reflecting on this wonderful series and just the thing, part of what I really like about both reading all biographies is you really get that people are humans with some good stuff and their opportunities for growth. John Adams was brilliant. Brilliant. He was also a little bit of an egotist. And luckily he had a good wife who helped him navigate those waters. You see, we forget about that. We always like to put everybody on monuments and make them like they're, oh, they just were that way. Sometimes I think back about John F. Kennedy and how we all sort of think of John F. Kennedy, right? The saint. And yet he was a human being. He had his good things, he had his not so good things, but we want to kind of, we want to put people on a pedestal. But I think there's a flaw in doing that. Rather, I think we are wise to look at the fullness of people, to look at their character flaws and how they have overcome them. We speak here often about this idea of that sort of what's different about us from many Christian traditions is that we're not looking to Jesus as the great example or as the great exception to who we are, as the person we put on a pedestal, as the entryway into another dimension. But rather we see him as the great example that if we follow his teachings and his practice, then we can open for ourselves that higher dimension. It's subtle, but it's true. So as we are looking at this, we're looking at who do I want to be? When I came into the teaching, I came in as a victim. Life was happening to me. And I didn't like what was happening at all. I didn't understand at the time, however, that I was co-creating in a process to have life happen exactly how it was happening. And so when I began to delve into the teachings, which helped me to understand that I am a powerful being, that I am powerful because I am working with universal intelligence and universal principles that will fulfill themselves through me, through the power of my declaration, through the power of my understanding, through the power of my embodiment of who I am. And so there's this journey of going from the head, where we intellectually understand things, where we can recite verse or scripture or even Charles' famous 12 powers, to an understanding that all of those teachings need to move into the heart, into that place of courage. Brené Brown says that is where we are authentic. It's not just thinking life is good. It's having a heartfelt experience of how good life is. It's different, isn't it? And so the work is about moving from the intellectualized ideas into our heart and our way of being and our way of living. It takes courage, my friends, to live in that state. I just think you should tell you this. When you declare a revolution, the fighting begins. I remember well my friend, dear friend, actually it's her birthday today, years ago told me that she had two kids, her and her husband were both alcoholic. Things were not great. And so she had a realization. Some call it hitting bottom, but others call it having a realization that this is not working. And so she did what a lot of people do. She got sober. Now, what would you think happened? The family rejoiced and said, "Hallelujah!" No? Some of you are from this background. What happened was everybody turned on her, including the kids. Like, what are you doing? You are messing with our family dynamic, and we do not like it. It makes us uncomfortable. Now, she stayed with her journey, and of course, eventually her husband came into the program, and, you know, the new dynamics got to work out. But I just share this with you because so often we think we're just going to declare the thing, and all is well, and people, you're going to go and have brunch with somebody today, not from this church, and you're going to go, oh, my God, I just found out I am a part of God. Isn't that wonderful? I am powerful beyond measure. Isn't that great? And they're going to look at you like you can either some kind of stupid or some kind of crazy. And they haven't figured out which yet, right? It is. Well, we won't judge. So for me, as we look at this, we are blessed that we get to live in a country that encourages us to pursue our happiness. And what many of us know is there is a difference between having freedom and being free. You see, Nelson Mandela, after all those years in prison, walked out, and rather than being bitter and angry and seeking revenge, he took that experience and helped change a nation. And he was very insightful in his awareness and understanding that he said, "I learned that courage was not the absence of fear, but the triumph over it." Love that. Courage was not the absence of fear, but the triumph over it. The brave man is not the one who does not feel afraid, but he is one who conquers that fear. See, I recently had an experience where I was helping someone, and I realized that I was not helping at all. Because this person had no framework for what I was talking about. Hadn't done the basics. Didn't realize that he was the co-creator of his life. That his life was playing out according to his beliefs, according to his pain. And I realized that I was wasting both of our time. That I was not the teacher, because I got to tell you, I have less and less patience for that in these days, right? I like to play with people that want to go deep. And so I'm not judging, I'm just saying, I was that realization like, oh, you have no idea what I am talking about. I could have been speaking German. It's like, what, you know? So it was just another aha, like, okay, so that gets to allow me to say, I like to work with people that want to do the deep work, that have done a basics, know some basic understanding of metaphysics, of who they are, of all that sort of thing. And that's where I can be most powerful, most helpful. You see, there's some steps we have to go through as we are declaring our freedom and living in the state. You see, I believe that we were born to be free, that we were born to be free of fear, free of stress, free of the past, that we are free to be strong and wise and perfectly unique. Isn't that wonderful? Perfectly unique. That you are a once in a forever, once in an eternity experience that God is having uniquely through you. That's fabulous. Didn't make you better or worse than anyone else. It just means that you are unique. So let us celebrate our uniqueness. Let us celebrate who we are. The courage to be free also calls upon us to follow our heart. It is most important that we have the courage to follow our heart and our intuition, because that part of us, that spiritual self, that divinely connected self, knows our highest good. So many of us have been conditioned over the years to not trust our intuition. We have been taught that everything needs to be logical and sequential and neat and orderly. But I say, lo unto you, because I can. I always wanted to say, lo unto you. But we have two minds. We're beginning to understand. We have an emotional intelligence as well as an intellectual intelligence. And that as we are balancing as spiritual beings, we're learning to trust that Spirit is calling us forward. Spirit is guiding us. And when our spiritual intuition is conflicting with our logical mind, very often that we find a limiting belief. Spirit says to us, I want you to play big. And you say, well, you don't understand. You don't know where I came from. So we're saying, play big. Be who you are. Celebrate your uniqueness. The spiritual principles also require us to let go of the familiar. This is why it takes courage. You see, back all those years ago when a group of rowdy people in the 13 colonies said, this is enough. We're going to do this different. And they came together to declare a state of independence. What followed from that was a releasing of the familiar. You knew what you could expect. And there were those that said, no, we need to stay in this and make it work. And there were those who said, we cannot make this work because it is contrary to our ideals. And so we will follow a path that is unfamiliar. They did not have 50 other nations to look to say, here's how you do it. And so they came together to form some ideals to declare themselves independent of a limiting state of being and were willing to pledge all to that. More and more, I have great respect for those who are willing to follow this path. Those who are willing to stand in the midst of chaos and say, there is peace. Those that are willing to stand in the midst of fear and say, there is love. Those who are willing to live the Christ-like life that Jesus had an example for us. Someone once said that if we could see each other the way the divine sees us, we could not help but fall to our knees in adoration. We are magnificent beings. And yet, the world does not always celebrate our magnificence. The struggle is real, folks. The struggle is real. And so how good it is, part of why I love spiritual community, is because it allows us to gather together with like-minded people that say, yes, celebrate who you are. I love that I get to be part of a congregation that has tall people and short people and wide people and skinny people and black people and brown people and white people and gay people and straight people and trans people. And we're all just like, cool, come on down. You're a child of God. Whatever your labels are, we're grateful you're here. That's magnificent, my friends. And I want to tell you, it's not something that happens a lot in our world. So we're part of something. It speaks to my heart over and over. We get to celebrate who we are. The other thing that I would have you understand is that when you are following your heart and you are called to this divine ideal and you don't know how it's going to happen, it may not even make sense to you. There is something within you that knows. Teacher once said, understand that spiritual principle is never bound by precedent. In other words, it doesn't have to have happened before for it to happen now. The inventors, the creators, the innovators are those who take an idea and bring it into being. I share sometimes with my mom's experience of her going from being a stay-at-home mom after the divorce, she needed to get a job. Now, she had a lot of experience of changing diapers, real diapers back in the day, just saying. She said, 10 years I never left my house without a diaper bag on my arm. And so she found herself needing to work, no education, happened to meet a neighbor of ours who had started a little company you're all familiar with called Perky Pet Products. Right? You're not familiar. Some of you are. Perky Pet Products are the world's largest manufacturer of hummingbird feeders. And I'm guessing a bunch of you have some. Now, you may have bought an but, you know, this was an idea. This is one of those great American stories of a guy sitting in his garage wanting to feed his hummingbird feeders and figuring out a way to do it. And they said, you know, I could do this. And before they know it, about the time my mom started, they were down in Denver, when Denver, downtown Denver, was scary. And this thing just blew up. Partnered with a little company you may have heard of called Walmart, which will change your life. You see, it was an idea followed upon by action, brought into expression. It takes courage. That's why I love entrepreneurs. I love innovators. I love people that are willing to say, I have this idea. I don't know how exactly how to do it, but I'm going to follow the dream in my heart. I love people that are willing to break beyond the bounds of what has been, to experience their fullness, to bring forth their greater good. So it requires us to let go of the familiar. It allows us to feel the fear and yet act anyways. Right? It's not the absence of fear. It's the ability to move forward in spite of the fear until the fear is no more. It requires uncertainty. It requires unfamiliarity. It requires discomfort. Other than that, it's great. Right? So this is why it takes courage. You see, I believe there comes a point in all of our lives as spiritual beings on this path where we're going to say, do I believe more in the spiritual than in the physical? Not to deny the physical, but to recognize that it is the spiritual that leads to a new condition. And that is from the level that I will work. And so that is why I admire each one of you. That is why I believe we are about doing good work. Michael Beckwith once said that there is a truth of our own divine nature, that we travel the path of awakening only to discover that we have been enlightened all along. When we get it, we're like, it's so simple. Not easy, but simple. So my friends, my spiritual warriors, my declarers of freedom, let us celebrate this season of freedom. Let us have the courage to be who we are. Let us go forth and prosper. What is that? I don't know. That was just another thing. A different show, different program. Okay. Some of you will get it. And let us begin in prayer. Please join me. As we simply stand in this awareness of the divine life, expressing itself in, through, and as all of creation, that this life is our life right now. It is indeed our divine inheritance that we are born of original source and substance, and that all of those qualities of the divine, of wholeness and perfection and joy and love and harmony and compassion and all of our good already exists. It is already who we are. So we take this time not to ask for something, but rather to declare what already is. We know that we are whole, perfect beings, and we allow that wholeness to express as health and well-being and vitality. We know that we exist in a sea of divine love, and so we fully and freely forgive. And we allow ourselves to be forgiven. We choose to open our hearts to the experience of divine love and to see our perfect imperfection, or our imperfect perfection. We see with the eyes of love and allow our relationships to be healed and transformed through the power of this love. We recognize and know that we are abundant beings right here and now because we live in divine source. And so we open our hearts to experience the divine flow. We joyously give and we graciously receive of this divine bounty. As simple as breathing, we allow ourselves to participate in the divine. We are blessed right here and right now. And so we bless this spiritual community. We bless the ministries and the work that it does. We bless our brothers and sisters of all types. We recognize there's only one race, and that is the human race. And therefore, we are all brothers and sisters of the Most High, of this Mother, Father, God. We celebrate a world that works for all, and we hold a vision for a planet at peace. And as we speak this word of truth, we also bless all priests, rabbis, ministers, teachers of all faiths. We know there are many pathways to the divine, and so we give thanks that this is so. We extend forth this blessing to all, and I know that it is already done, it is already established, and I am so grateful. As together we say, and so it is. Amen.
But now that doesn't mean a thing. I'm living for the joy and laughter. I'm learning from my befores and afters. All and all, it's been cool. God's grace has brought me through. I'm so happy. be being me. Oh, I'm so happy being me. I'm regretting nothing about me. Too busy living life, giving love freely. I'm so happy being me. Stop looking back for your beginnings. All those broken dreams that went downstream. And as we grow, we live and know. Some things were never meant to be. And everything that you've been through was God's design just to bless you. That's why He gives us memories to lead us to our victory. I'm so happy loving me. Ooh, I'm so happy being me. I'm regretting nothing about me.
Y'all can join me, come on.
I'm too busy living life, giving love freely. I'm so happy being me. All of life's hidden treasures I'm enjoying, nothing but pleasures. And we can never replace God's love. Oh, and the sunlight leads us to a place, and the moonlight keeps us in His grace. Oh, oh yes. Oh, yeah, yeah. No one else I would rather be. Oh, I'm so, so happy being me. Regretting nothing,
come on, join me,
about me. Look at somebody and tell them, I'm too busy. I'm too busy living life, giving love freely. I'm so happy being me, so happy being me. I'm regretting nothing about me.
That's right.
I'm too busy living life, giving love freely. I'm so happy being me.
You can sing, come on, I'm so happy.
I'm regretting nothing,
that's right,
about me.
I see you over there, that's right, regret nothing about you.
Too busy living life, giving love freely. I'm so happy being me.
Namaste to you all. God bless you.
How blessed are we? So I want to tell you I love you. And I'm out of here. No. I have this little window of opportunity to see my niece that I haven't seen in 4 years, so I'm dashing out of here to go see her. So I love you. I made you chili just to make up for leaving so quickly, but I wanted to let you know I won't stick around afterwards as I normally do. But you can enjoy lunch, and you could talk to each other. It would be okay. In fact, I'd invite you to. We have a lot of new folks with us, and it's always good to get to know some new folks. So why don't you stand with me and say the prayer of protection and to sing the peace song. Thank you. Together. The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us.
And the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is,
and all is well.